Hey YouTubers, Dave here, Home Server Show. We're going to do number 279 tonight. We're going to be talking about the HP Stream Mini Desktop with friend of the show, Dwayne Robinson. And hey, just a precursor, if you've searched here and you found HP Stream Mini Desktop and you want some information, this is going to be a lot of information, but it is a discussion that's going to be about an hour long. If you're looking for a 3-minute review, you've come to the wrong video. I'm just telling you up front, this is for a podcast at homeservershow.com. This will be an hour long. It's a discussion, not a review. I have to say that, Dwayne.
No problem.
Okay. So guys in the chat room, everybody see us? Video good. Audio. Hey guys. Okay, maybe not. Let me get my chat window. Got too much stuff around me.
See if I can make myself not look nuclear.
You've got quite the reflection there off your...
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody says we're good in the chat room. If you're watching on YouTube, you can go to homeservershow.com, click the live podcast link, and you can chat with us instantly. No logins, no passwords, no money required. Okay, here we go. Make another news on blog. Here we go. Home Server Show. Click that link. Okay. Ready? This is the Home Server Show podcast, episode number 279, recorded on March the 18th, 2015. Welcome back to the Home Server Show podcast. I'm your host, Dave McCabe, joined by Mr. Dwayne Robinson tonight. How are you doing, Dwayne?
Doing good, Dave. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Thanks for coming on the show with us. I say us, but Jim Collison, he's at home. He's got family stuff going on. I think it's his wife's birthday today. You just don't podcast on that day. Otherwise, you're in the doghouse, mister. So we'll get Jim back here maybe next week. I know, Dwayne, we're going to have quite a few shows with you, but tonight we're going to be talking about the HP Stream Mini Desktop. Now, we're not talking HP Stream little tablet here, like I've got the little Stream 7. We're talking about the little mini desktop. And if you followed me on my CES travels, I stopped by HP and got a look at it, and we got to open one up and got to play with one. It was really kind of cool. And back then, it was just announced. I mean, it was just announced at CES, so it's really cool. They're out there in the wild, and Dwayne and I are going to take one apart. We're going to upgrade it. We're going to talk about it, and we're going to talk about what it runs really well and what it's meant for, and we're going to have some good fun with that. But don't forget, you can follow this podcast at Home Server Show. You can follow me at McCabe.io. That's my new alter ego, McCabe.io. on Twitter. And we're part of the Geeks Network. The Geeks Network. We've got a good collection of podcasts, and we're adding to those. I don't want to tell you now because I don't have the artwork up, but we're adding a couple of shows in the near future, probably in the next week. And I'll be able to tell you about those next week, I hope. I think three shows. We're adding three podcasts to the Geeks Network, which is really freaking exciting. That's really kind of cool. Okay. Now, Dwayne, I need to get through a couple of pieces of news. But the first piece of news I know you are very well familiar with, because you're a two-time attendee of the Home Server Show annual meetup.
They're exciting.
They are exciting. So, Jim and I talked... Yeah, two years ago, there were lasers and fire trucks. Thank you very much. we skipped last week because I was a little under the weather, but I got the chance to talk with Jim, and we kind of settled on, I hope I have this right, guys, September 12th. Now, some of us, we wanted to move it into August. We wanted to move it into October. We just couldn't find a day that worked. So I'm going to say it right now, completely unofficial, though. Unofficials. I don't want you guys booking your airline tickets yet, just in case. Give me another week, maybe 2 weeks, but start penciling in the weekend of September 12th. That's probably where we're going to have the annual meetup. And I think it's going to be, I think we're going to have a pretty good one this year. I'm already excited about it. Already excited. Dwayne, you going to come?
I am. I have to check the date to make sure that's also around the time that my wife and I are planning to go on our 15-year anniversary trip.
Well, what a beautiful place to visit for your anniversary. The great state of Indiana.
Yes, I hear it's wonderful, especially with the snow.
Hey, you brought her last time, and she was real fun to be around. So, you know, even if you have to work, you know, she's invited.
Oh, okay. Most people like my wife better than me anyway.
She was pretty cool. Let's get into just a little bit of news, and then we'll jump into the HP Stream Mini. Synology released a beta. Well, this is a pretty big deal. It's really kind of cool when Synology releases a beta because anybody can participate. They don't make you jump through hoops. You just have to go to their page. I think you click a few things, and then bam, you're in the beta. You can download it. You can apply it to your Synology box if you would like. You know, they always say don't apply it to your box that's running, you know, your backups and all your stuff, just in case something was to happen. Don't run it on a live server. But I always have, I have multiple. Dwayne, I know that you do as well, and we're going to get you in here, you know, in the near future to talk about some Synology boxes. But and I'm going to say this real lightly, and I don't want you to take, everybody listen, I don't want you to take this to like, this is supreme fact, but I've found that Synology betas are really pretty stable. If you really like one of the features, you can try it. I'm not going to say, you know, don't put it on stuff that's important if you don't have it backed up to some other location. The thing is if something does go wrong, you can't go back. There's no going back. Once you put that beta on, it can only upgrade to a new release, which would be a newer beta, which they do, or the final version.
So buyer beware.
Yes. But then again, if you have a secondary box, I wouldn't worry about it. Even if that box functions as something important, you may want to check the forums to see, make sure it's running Plex okay, or, you know, something like that. But DSM 5.2, hang on, I've got something in my eye. It's my finger, really. They released a couple of really, this is almost like a business release. Dwayne, I don't know if you've been able to look at this, but there's a new feature called Docker.
Oh yeah, I'm familiar with Docker.
You can install apps on Synology. I mean, that's no problem. You can put Surveillance Station, Cloud Station, downloads. I mean, you can even put PHP in WordPress. But they're taking it a step further, and they're allowing you to like containerize these installs. So let's say you do want to run PHP, MySQL, and WordPress as like a development WordPress site for your website. You can run those in a small container. That way, if you blow it up, it's not going to crater your entire Synology box. So it's really kind of cool. Now, those, I think, are going to be some of the more popular ones, but there's all kinds of little pieces of software that's going to be available out there. There's file improvements in NoteStation. There's improvements with FileStation. FileStation can mount cloud drive storage such as OneDrive, Dropbox, Google Drive, probably some others. And it's going to make it look like it's just right there in your file station, just right there on your NAS. But it's mounted that, you know, out there in the cloud. So, you know, I know a lot of things are doing that now, but that's kind of cool. That is really kind of cool.
Hey, Dave, you know, I was talking to a friend of mine who's a fan of the show, Rob Dentler, mm-hmm. who came out to the show. And he was telling me that the Cloud Sync software was just updated as well. So if you were doing OneDrive, it would take a lot of your bandwidth keeping things up to sync. Now you can actually set that on schedules to control that. So there's a big update for Cloud Sync that just came out as well.
Okay. Maybe that was, I think, update one, update two. I know one of those two did have some stuff for OneDrive, choosing that as a cloud destination as well. So that's kind of cool.
Yep.
I am, man, I'm telling you, I am like this far from being able to shut down my Windows Server 2012 and just live on a Synology box. I mean, it's that close. I mean, it's really coming together.
Yeah, I did that at my house, so I've actually shut down all the Windows servers except for labs. So.
Yeah, yeah. Now, I'm really, I would probably still run the server because I love having the running VMs out of that thing. That is just the coolest thing. Yeah, I'm running a Minecraft server for the Xbox. And I'm also running a Minecraft server for handheld edition for the iPads. So the boys can connect to it and build and save and all kinds of cool stuff. So,
yeah, I told my daughter your story from the last episode where you were talking about the Minecraft server for your son. And my daughter goes, why would you ever want to do that, Daddy? So it's the opposite of yours.
Yeah, my boys were psyched. They're like, you can make a server? Oh my God. Snap your fingers, make it happen. So it was kind of cool. That's kind of cool that the boys are into that, but
my daughter was more like, Dad, you're a nerd.
Yeah. I understand. I do understand. So 5.2 beta DSM for your Synology box. Go take a look. We talked about this with Mr. Microserver, but John Stutzman has another post out there on the DL320E. Now, this is an HP ProLiant. This is a 1U rack server, and it's a huge server. And we had this server at the last meetup, Dwayne. I don't know if you remember. It was in the back. The guys were spinning it up, trying to put things on it, and we sent that home with John Stutzman. He's been working on it and playing with it. And we're trying to do a mini meetup up sort of around the Madison, Illinois border, kind of Madison, Wisconsin area. So John can be able to hand that off to either, I don't know who's getting it next, maybe Scoondoggy in the forums or CS Kinney, our forums admin. Chris Kinney, he may be getting it next. I'm not really sure, but we're trying to pass that thing around to get some more people on it and take a look at that. So, Mr. Microserver.
It's kind of like the brotherhood of the traveling server.
Yeah, that's okay. It. That's it. Yep, traveling server. And so check all this out at homeservershow.com, just right there on the front of the website. If you haven't been there in a while, you should go there. I've got a brand new kind of look and feel to the site. You can take a look, see what you think of that. Okay, now it's on, Dwayne. It is on. The HP Stream Mini Desktop. Now this thing is, I mean, this is smaller than a personal pan pizza right here. And I saw it at CES. It had an HDMI port, and I immediately thought, as you probably immediately thought first, Media Center. We still love our Media Center, but let's talk about, before we get anything installed on it, let's talk about just the hardware itself. And man, let's just start with real quick. You know, I was going to say jump into it, but maybe Give me 30-second synopsis on you, Dwayne, because maybe some folks don't really recognize you. If you've done a meetup, I know you recognize Dwayne Robinson, but Dwayne, just introduce yourself, man.
Yeah, I set places on fire, apparently. So so I'm Dwayne Robinson. I actually do work for Microsoft, so if I have to make sure transparency is there in case anyone has any questions about that. I do a role called an enterprise architect in our strategy consulting group, and I've been working there for about 10 years. But as Dave can tell you, we've talked a lot about, you know, some of the things that I do that are beyond this, just, you know, Microsoft core things. I have a lot of experience with media servers and, like Dave said, multiple Synologies. I have a lot of other things I'm doing, and this particular purchase and thing, I called up Dave one day and I said, "Dave, you're not going to believe this. I got this cool thing because I'm rigging up my RV," and so with a mobile entertainment center. So we'll talk more about that later. But definitely, it's kind of all things computers and nerd. That's me.
I agree. You're quite the nerd, but we still enjoy you. Now, Dwayne's been great to have kind of in the community. You know, this is a community. He hangs out at I've seen you in the Surface Geeks forums quite a bit, and yeah. You're starting to kind of come around to the Home Server Show kind of forums. I think we've kind of put the bug into you.
Yeah, it's a lot easier to post things on non-Microsoft things than Microsoft things. It's a little easier not to worry about.
Right.
Do I have press?
Yeah, we can talk about HP and Synology and all that kind of stuff. So, all right. So we got the HP Stream Mini Desktop. Now let's talk about the hardware, because I know there's several different flavors of this thing.
Yeah. So there's actually two different versions of the same form factors. So let's just make sure we clarify some things. So that if you're looking for the one that I'm going to be talking about specifically, it's referred to as the HP Stream Mini Desktop, and the model is 200-010. You'll know which one we're talking about because it is blue. The other ones are actually referred to as a Pavilion Mini Desktop, and they'll be like 300-something, depending on it. And there are two models of that one. So, but from a hardware spec, you want to talk about kind of what it comes with first here, Dave?
Yeah, let's just establish what's on the box and all the ports and the stuff, and then we'll open it up.
Okay, well, so from a ports perspective, well, let's talk about the processor and RAM real quick. Yep. So the processor on this thing is an Intel Celeron. It's that 2957U. It's basically a 1.4 gigahertz processor, dual core, 2 mega cache. And I've got some more interesting stuff on that processor when we talk a little later on specifics of what we can do with this thing. However, beyond that, it comes with 2 gigs of RAM. It's DDR3L, 1600 megahertz RAM. And then it also has a 32 gig SATA SSD, but it's an M.2 SSD. So that is an interesting part about it. Where the other devices that HP offers in the same form factor in the Pavilion series, they actually don't use the SSD. They use spinning drives in those. So just be aware of that as we go through. But I think the most interesting thing, Dave, is this thing has 4 USB 3.0 ports, Bluetooth 4.0, it's got gigabit Ethernet, it's got a display port, and an HDMI port. And I'm going to hold it up. Maybe you can kind of see the back of it here where it has all the ports. And then there's 2 more that are sitting on the front that are USB. On the side, you've actually got a full SD card slot, so that you can add some storage that way as well. And then from a wireless standpoint, it'll do B, G, and N. So pretty cool thing.
Back me up to the storage again. So you're saying the Pavilion comes default with spinners?
Yes, they come default with spinners, and to be specific, there's two versions of that model, right? The top-end model is an i3 processor, and that comes with a 5400 RPM 1 TB SATA drive, where if you're looking at the middle of the road one, it has the Pentium processor, and then it has a 500 gig 7200 RPM drive. So it's actually funny, the speed of the drive is fastest in the cheapest one and slowest in the biggest, but the capacity seems to be the difference here.
Right. I wonder if they were trying to maybe save a little money, because since there's an i3 in there, maybe they just cut it back with put that 5400 in there.
Oh, yeah. I think that's probably what they had to do to be able to get it. Not to mention it's a 2.5-inch drive, so a lot of what you're seeing is that. But
okay, so now this little one, the mini.
The blue one.
no SSD. Is it a little mSATA that I can pull on and off?
Yeah, I'll actually crack it open in a second and show you.
Okay.
But it's an M.2. I've found it that you can upgrade it all the way to 256 gigs of storage on just the M.2 card upgrade. It is nothing. It's interesting. Nothing seems to be soldered to this motherboard that, for the most part. So it's very modular, which is amazing for this price point.
It's going to be amazing if I don't order one of these by the end of the month. That's what's going to be amazing.
So Dave, I'm going to show you something in this video that's just going to, and keep in mind as we go through this, this is the HP Mini.
Mm-hmm.
This is a CD.
Good God. Layer it over it. That's pretty cool. Hang on, let me snip that real quick. Bam.
So when we're talking about this thing, you got to get it. It's hard to necessarily tell in the pictures how small it really is. It's like you said, when you saw it out and about, you know, remember I was telling you my daughter wasn't excited about the whole Minecraft server, but when she saw this thing, she's like, Daddy, how is that a computer? You know, and so she loved it, and it's blue.
So,
yes. So I think one interesting thing is also to call out the price point, Dave.
Yeah.
This thing is $179.
I know. That's nuts.
And when I got it, I was actually worried because I was like, okay, well, this thing's going to come with nothing. But it comes with a full keyboard and it comes with a mouse. And so now they're not wireless, but the fact they're actually pretty decent, though.
Well,
so,
I mean, if you were going to a store, that's a $20 set right there. Right?
Yeah, and it's a spare set just in case you need one, right?
Right. So now we're kind of down to the 159, and it has hard drive in it, and it has RAM in it, right?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's ready to go.
Yeah, and the crazy thing is, if you go look at the performance stats on this M.2 SSD that's in this thing, people, there are videos all over YouTube. This thing performs like you wouldn't believe from just a disk performance standpoint. I mean, boot times are insane.
Yeah. Well, that's that mSATA. I mean, that's crazy.
Oh yeah. It's pretty awesome.
That's something awesome about just HP itself. I mean, they've just made this thing upgradable. I mean, they could have locked this thing down to, you know, it could be Mac Mini. I hate to say that, but
oh yeah. No, it's actually what first thing I thought of, Dave, was this is like a Mac Mini for $179.
Yeah.
So
the funny thing is it has a Celeron processor, which is 10 times better than the Atom processor that is in my media center today. It's three times smaller. It's just crazy. I mean, that is crazy. And I almost bought one. And side note, we were talking about my media center woes, and I was able to fix those by just refreshing it and taking out every power management feature known to Windows 7. Something in there was ganking up, and my media center's been running really well. So unfortunately, I can't slip this purchase by the accounting department, but...
Oh, yeah. Well, don't worry. My accounting department, when we lost our HD Home Run Prime this past week, immediately said, you're on Amazon. Replace that because all our TV was down.
Fix it now. Yeah, that's how you do it, is you just blow it up. My accounting department would say, you did that on purpose, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. So you were talking about the processor on this, Dave. Mm-hmm. Just to give you an idea of that processor and the value behind it, I pulled this up on Intel's website, and I've put the link to this directly in the show notes for everybody. But this thing is, you know, it's 64-bit chip instruction set. According to the recommended customer price from Intel's website, is $107. It supports up to 16 gigs of RAM, and it supports virtualization technology as well. So
it has the virtualization mark in the BIOS and in the CPU.
Yeah, so in theory, unreal. I haven't tried it yet, but it's on the to-do list to take this thing and load it up with Hyper-V.
Unreal. I'm looking for it in Amazon. Am I able to buy this at Amazon? I see the Pavilion.
Yeah, so I put a link in the show notes that you can look at. You can also go to HP's website. What's happening is this thing is in such high demand that when they run out of stock on Amazon, they don't show it to you in the search. Okay. So what's in there that I gave you in the show notes is the link directly in Amazon. But you can also go. Looks like it's in stock right now on HP's website for $179.99.
Yeah, I'm seeing HP links much easier than I am Amazon. So everybody, if you're interested in this, check the show notes at homeservershow.com. You're going to be able to find this podcast. It's number 279. It'll probably be at the top. Click those links. That'll help pay for the bandwidth. I guess if you buy one, I think it might with HP's site. I don't know. Okay, so we got the processor taken care of. We can go 16 gig on the RAM, and that just a little notebook SODIMM?
Yeah, and by the way, there was a question here in the chat room I just saw go by on the virtualization. Is it VT-X or VT-D? It's VT-X.
Okay.
Okay. So yes, it actually has the SODIMMs. Do you want me to probably, best to kind of show you a little bit here. Bear with us, people who are listening to audio, but if you pull this little rubber thing off the back, there's only like three screws that take this off, and then you can just basically drop the whole thing out.
Okay, so there's a rubber footing on the bottom, and then the case just comes apart.
Yes, and then there's a tray that sits up here atop. Underneath this tray, and I may just, while we're talking, go ahead and take the other parts off so that you can see it. But basically underneath that tray, there's two slots. The way it comes is it has 2 gigs in a single DIMM and an open DIMM slot from the factory.
2 gigs in one DIMM slot, and it has one open DIMM slot.
Correct. So a total of 2 DIMM slots.
So the best bet is remove that one and just replace it with a couple. I mean, probably a couple of 4s would be really cheap, wouldn't it?
Yes. So what I did is instead of spending the money to replace it with both of them, I just bought another 4 gig DIMM, and I put the link to the one I bought in the show notes. And so now I'm running 6 gigs of RAM in the device.
Okay, so you can mismatch them.
Yes, and not only that, maximum on this thing is 16 gigs of RAM. It will run a full 16 in this unit. So, which is pretty impressive when you think about, you know, price point, size, and so forth to have 16 gigs of RAM in a device. And you're only talking, I think to go up to 16, you're probably talking about, you know, $100,
$150. Okay. I don't see your notes, but we'll figure that out later.
Okay. Well, I'll make sure we get those over. So, but I've actually took the tray off here for you now so you can get a little bit better view.
And if you're listening on audio, don't fear. I'm not going to make you go through the entire YouTube, but as Dwayne's holding up the mini, I'm taking some screenshots. So when he's pointing out specific features, you'll be able to see. I guess I'll put them on the show notes post, and you can see those. So hold that up. What do you got for me there?
So right there, you can see that the two DIMMs sitting there, one's underneath the other, kind of slightly, you know, at an angle. Mm-hmm. And so the one that's on top is the new 6 gig that I've put in, and you can see it's got a lot more chips on it.
Okay. How much was that? Did you tell me already?
$31.99.
Oh, that's easy.
And then right below that, if you see this thing that looks like a white box, actual M.2.
Wait. Let me get screen cap of that. Okay. That's the that's a lot smaller than I thought it would be. I thought these things were long.
So there's different options. There's the short ones and the long ones. This one won't take the long one. I thought it would, but there's some things that block the long ones. So you can put the smaller ones in. I was looking at that. It's about $100 or so for you to go to 256 gig. I would say, you know, think about what you're going to do with it. It does have gigabit Ethernet, and there's also another little trick to this thing. We talked about the other models that existed, and what we found out when I did research on this and started looking on the web is I found out that other people were cracking open the mini desktop that was the Pavilion, and they were realizing that it had an M.2 slot with nothing in it. So the motherboard between these different units is the same, and HP's not changing it. So if you bought one of the higher-end units, you can add an M.2. So the question became, could you add a second hard drive, a spinner, or an SSD? And if you notice this little tray that I took off, it actually has the mounting to be able to mount a 2.5-inch drive. The only problem you ran into is how do you connect it? Well, there's an actual little port. I don't know if you can see it here too well, but it's white.
Let the camera focus. Oh, put it over your face. Yeah, block your face, Dwayne.
I don't need...
Come on, camera. I'll just get to take it right there. Okay.
So that little port is actually the SATA connection. And so what I did is I found out that there's a part number that goes to the other devices. HP hasn't made it where through their parts department you can buy it yet, but what I'm seeing is a lot of people are starting to ask for that, but it will be just a small ribbon cable that allows you to connect in, because that SATA connection is actually live from what we've been told.
Okay, so that's live in the BIOS. We're not going to have to get BIOS mods to open that thing up for us. Okay.
Yes, so pretty awesome.
Now, is there, I'm just going to ask a dumb question, is there an M-SATA to SATA type ribbon cable connector converter?
Yeah, you can go on eBay or you can go on Amazon and kind of look for M.2 converters to SATA. The main thing you'll run into is you need to make sure that you get one that also has the power connection, because there's no way to power the drive otherwise. So just that's the main thing you got to look out for when you're looking at those particular things. But that's pretty impressive, though, that even that there's an option or possibility. And keep in mind, I've still got a full SD card connection left in this thing that is completely functional from the factory, followed with 4 USB 3.0 ports. So from a storage capacity and hanging, you know, additional drive space off of it, you can go pretty big.
I like it. It's going to be interesting if they do come out with a little ribbon cable that's, you know, not a bazillion dollars that you can load up. You just slide an SSD in there.
It's going to be $179, Dave.
Yeah, probably.
So there was one other little thing about it when you crack it open that I thought was interesting, and that other thing was over up right here is the it is actually a replaceable wireless card. So if you can find those little portal, the like laptop type of wireless cards that come into this, you should be able to upgrade this thing to AC if you wish.
I've seen folks doing that with Lenovo laptops and stuff, so I'm sure that this is, you're going to be able to do this as well. Although, I mean, it's got Ethernet. If you'd have to be, you'd have to really have a reason to want to put this somewhere that, you know, you didn't have Ethernet access.
Yeah, and not only that, it's got gigabit Ethernet.
Sure.
So that's pretty awesome. Now, I was a little concerned when I got this because I was looking at it specifically as like a media puck type of device. Actually, specifically as a Plex server for my RV. And when I came to figure to looking at this thing, my big concern was, would the HDMI port extend audio? And the answer is yes. So one cable out, audio does, it is wired up for audio to come out of the HDMI. Because some places where they're cutting cost, that's where you'll see them cut a little cost.
True. Now, we've seen that, and we've seen that it's in the Home Server Show forums quite a bit. Some guys have found that to be true, but that's good. So it'll go straight to, you don't have to put it in your RV, folks. You don't have to buy an RV, but you can make this a media center. What software is loaded on it?
So what it comes with is it comes with Windows 8.1 with Bing. Interestingly enough, it didn't have a lot of crapware on it. It definitely had some. Most of it was like links and things to websites that you could just right-click and install off the desktop. So nothing major. I didn't rebuild it. But what I've decided to run on top of it at this point is I'm running a whole host of Windows 8 applications such as Xbox Video, Xbox Music, all of those type of services. As you can imagine, me being a Microsoft guy, I tend to run those type of things. But I also am running a Plex server on it. And it's interesting because I thought I was going to take a Synology and run the Plex server off of Synology. But when I started doing a cost comparison of getting enough processing power in the Synology to cover the cost of the upgrade to the Synology, it was actually more functional just to take this device and connect it up to the Synology and let the Synology do my storage and let this device actually do the Plex server itself. But okay. And since I went ahead and did that, I went ahead and said I'm going to sync Media Center content over, and it's also running media, it's also running Microsoft Media Center Edition.
Okay.
So
let's see. I mean, that makes a lot of sense. I mean, we're still in the $179 price range here. I'm still just, it's crazy to know that. All right. So everybody out there on YouTube, you can chat with us live. This is, if you're getting this later on as a video, this is live March 18th, 2015. HomeServerShow.com. There's a live podcast link, or you can just /live. And we have chat room. If you need to ask Dwayne a question, you can do that right now. We're going to kind of migrate into the software side of things on this HP. And we've got about 20 minutes in which to do so. So also don't forget we're a member of the Geeks Network, thegeeksnetwork.com. There's a lot of podcasts out there that real good podcasts, kind of like this one. So, you can enjoy those as well. Again, Dwayne Robinson, Microsoft, the HP Stream Mini Desktop. Media Center would be my choice. I'm a Media Center guy.
Yeah, and if you're doing a lot of encoding, Dave, the version that I was talking about that had the i3 processor in it, that box, just to give you an idea, it maxes out at $449. So you're looking at being able to do that, and I think the middle of the road box is 320. So if you're looking for a little bit more processing power than what these have,
right.
You can look at this, but is it powerful enough to run the Plex server? Is it powerful enough to run a media center that's not necessarily doing a bunch of recording, but maybe you're just viewing and things of that nature? It seems to be running fine, and I have had zero issues with performance on this wow. box.
How awesome is that? Now, before we get going on that, you did mention that it had the processor in there to run virtual environments. And that's yeah. one of the things that you were looking at to begin with?
Yeah, so didn't buy it for that. But what I ended up happening is as I was doing this, me and a lot of my enterprise architect friends are all having to get Azure certified. And so what we realized is that this box was powerful enough if you threw some RAM into it, if you got it up to about 8 gigs of RAM, to be able to run two virtual machines within it so that you could actually extend your home network to Azure. And so a lot of guys are looking at kind of using it as an appliance to connect their home network to Azure and then leveraging Azure to be able to expand. So if you've got an MSDN account, kind of a cool concept. You probably could do a show just on that, Dave.
I think we're probably going to have to. Let's do an Azure show in the future because I do have some questions. I have MSDN and I have Azure credits and I keep trying to figure out how I want to use these Azure credits. And I know Jim Collison, who has the night off tonight, he's a huge Azure guy. He loves it. I mean, he loves it and he runs a lot of stuff. And I think I need to get in on this game. So
yeah, and it's actually pretty cool, Dave, because if you've got like MSDN, I think it's like $150 a month you get.
Yeah.
And you can get a virtual machine for $14 a month in Azure. So with a full license to Windows Server 2012 R2 data center.
Yeah. Yeah, that may be my new server 2012 if I have to go, if I choose to go with a NAS instead. But maybe we can do some more of that at Meetup 2015. We can do some Azure presentations, maybe bring the mini desktop. Everybody's going to have one by then, though, Dwayne. You know that, right?
Well, why don't we do this, Dave? Why don't I bring it, and I'll set up a site-to-site VPN so we'll connect right into my Azure subscription, the Home Server Show Network.
Okay. We can do that. If I can get us enough bandwidth. Last time we had bandwidth issues, but...
Oh, that's true.
We survived. They didn't give me enough bandwidth this year. They're on to me. So they're on to me.
Yeah, we pretty much stuck the wireless under our own.
Right. We did.
So
let's see. So Media Center. I mean, this sure. thing's gonna be good under the TV, right?
Yeah, so I decided that the way I wanted this thing to work is I didn't want to see it. Because I wanted to hide it. And because it's small, you could hide it, right? Almost think of it like it's honestly really close to the size of a Roku. So when you're looking at it from that perspective, you start going, well, why couldn't I just use this thing as like a media hub or a streamer that is a Plex server or, you know, is a Plex consumer? You know, all of those things, that anything you could do with Windows 8, right? So pretty much I went out and I got a hold of some stuff, Dave. You want to see these things?
Yep.
So what I got a hold of is I got a hold of this Logitech keyboard. It's $31 and it's got a trackpad. I think it's called the K400.
Okay.
And this is an RF keyboard with a trackpad. So you just take and plug the little dongle that they've got into one of the USB ports. I just used one of the front ones. It's like one of those little bitty micro ones.
Oh, it's and just a little stick? Okay.
Yeah, it's almost completely flush with the USB port when you put it in. And it works well. I mean, there's a couple of things that you want to do in the software to kind of address it, but, you know, there's $30 and it'll work through a cabinet or whatever. It works across the room for me, so that's sufficient. And then I also bought one other thing, which is this remote that is made by, let me give you the model. This is like a weird type of device here. But basically what this is an RF Media Center remote. And so once I realized I was going to put Media Center, that it was powerful enough to run Media Center.
Yeah, I see the green button on it. So.
Yeah. Now, I will tell you that I'm not necessarily as happy with this device. It seems like it's fairly spotty from an RF.
Is it Microsoft branded, or is this a Microsoft product?
No, this is a third-party solution. And I will make sure that I put the notes on it for you guys. But basically what it is it's just an RF remote control. It does say Microsoft on it, but it is not made by Microsoft. It's actually made by a third party who's just using the Microsoft logo for the fact that it is branded and so forth. So, but like I said, it seems to work. It's one of those where you hit the button and it's not 100% consistent. I find myself falling back to the Logitech keyboard for it for the most part. And the gestures and everything work on the trackpad, so it really, really is no issue.
See, now that would be a fail in my household. It's remote or nothing, and I have a black one. We're talking 5-6 years old, and it has a little USB receiver.
Yeah, now those I think would work better. So if you were to hang this, and in my case in the RV, I can't hang something out of the cabinet. So, but for typical home use, if you get the one that looks just like this, that mm-hmm. is not RF, that it's IR, it works perfectly. Matter of fact, I ended up plugging the one from my Media Center downstairs into it so that I could test to make sure that the remote wasn't a problem with the machine running slow. And that was pretty much the device. It wasn't anything else. But it was cool. I mean, I'm pretty shocked that this thing can run all of these media things and it doesn't stutter a bit.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's a Celeron processor. I mean, I'm running Windows 7 on an Atom. So,
yeah. So, it's going to be pretty cool, and I think it's only going to get better as we move forward, because a lot of what we're seeing in Windows 10 actually seems like it's running even better on lower end hardware. So, mm-hmm. so it's pretty cool. I think there was one other thing that I found through my searches, the great value night late at night as I had this brainstorm of craziness of a solution. And it's this thing, Dave, which is a little HDMI switch. I ended up on Amazon because I was looking for this thing. This thing comes with this little cord, there's a dongle that's IR, so that you can hang it out like what we talked about before. So you can hide it in the back. And it comes with a little remote that lets you switch between three ports. Care to guess how much this is, Dave?
I'm going to go on a whim and say $19.95.
Dave, you're way off, buddy. This thing is $5.65 on Amazon.
How much is it? Wow, $5. Is this Prime or is this a Amazon seller?
It's not Prime, so you have to pay a whole 99 cents to ship it. But they do have one that if you want to get it, the four port and so forth. If you start looking at some of the others, you may want to look at some of the other options. But know that it also doesn't come with this cable, the power adapter that lets it, you know, extend it. So that's about another $5 for you.
Okay.
But it's a good deal if you're looking for a video switcher. I mean, that's not bad. So,
is it? I mean, can you confuse this thing? I've never used an HDMI switcher, and I honestly probably could, because every single TV I have only has four HDMIs, and I seem to load it up with all kinds of little boxes.
Yeah, it's kind of the situation. Same thing I run into, like in the RV, for example. It has a splitter that makes all the TVs work off of one thing. So being able to flip between sources is something you can't natively do. So that's really the reason I was looking at it. But it would be good for like a monitor switch, if you needed just to switch monitors, or something of that nature, or just a simple input between a Roku or something of that nature. So I just think it's a good deal if you have the use case. But you know, like I said, I found all these little crazy things as I was going through this process, which was pretty funny.
Nice. Nice. All right, that link will be in the show notes. Don't worry. We've got quite a few links for you. So we'll have links to the box, the upgrades, the RAM, the SATA cable part number, all kinds of good stuff. I mean, I see all kinds of stuff here.
Yeah, I tried to make sure that if I had pulled all that together for you in those show notes, so that way if people are looking for stuff we're talking about, they'll have it.
Yeah, and I've got my finger on the buy button. That's why I'm kind of delaying here. Like, oh, can I get away with this?
Ladies and gentlemen, Dave will own one within the hour, is what I'm hearing.
I'll probably buy one in the middle of Surface Geeks next hour.
So. Yeah. Well, and I think it's, like I said, I think it's pretty impressive. It's more that it's $179.99. If you needed kids desktop or something like that, this thing would be amazing. I mean, it's right in line with that whole Stream series, right? And I bought my daughter the Stream laptop for Christmas. Mm-hmm. She wanted one.
Pink?
Believe it or not, I couldn't find a pink one.
Okay.
But she saw the blue one at the Microsoft store and loved it.
Okay.
And so, you know, Daddy had to support the Microsoft store. Sure. And his little girl that wants to support the blue laptop. So.
Nice.
So, it's like I said, these things are... I'm seeing HP doing some crazy good stuff, man.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. They're Stream laptops, which I've said even before they hit the shelves on Surface Geeks, we were talking about these things are going to be crazy. Because people are going to see that color, and it's going to draw them in, and they're going to get one because they're cheap. And their Stream 7, their Stream 8 tablets, awesome. Doing very awesome. I've got the Stream 7 right here. I'm charging it. I think it's charged. I need to turn it on. But doing really well. So.
Oh, yeah.
And, of course, HP's always popular in the homeservershow.com forums with their microservers, the Gen 8 microserver, the N54L, the N40L, all those boxes are really popular out there. So, last question came in through chat was, does it have Visa mounts?
I have not seen any.
Okay.
So I will look and try to find out for you. Maybe post something in the forums if I can find one.
Okay. Yeah, that'd be cool if you could hang it on the back of the TV. But
yeah, on the back, because it's that rubber thing here, Dave, you can pull this off, but I'd have to reassemble it to see, because the chassis is actually what kind of comes through the back. So you kind of have to have it assembled to be able to really see if you could do it. I'm sure you could come up with something, maybe not quite as elegant as some of the Roku mounts.
Hey, zip ties. Solves everything. Zip ties
always work.
Solves everything.
Zip ties. I tell you what, you could very easily put some industrial Velcro on the back of this thing. It doesn't weigh enough to do it.
Hook and loop, baby. Hook and loop.
I'm sorry. It's hook and loop. Is that correct? Loop.
Yeah, we don't want to be sued by Velcro. Oh. Yeah. And on that note, I think that we've got a pretty good podcast in the books. Dwayne can be found at Dwayne, DEWAIN27 on Twitter. And he's often seen hanging around the SurfaceGeeks.net forums and soon the HomeServerShow.com forums. You're even out there in the home automation forums.com because you've got a huge Iris set up.
Yeah, I just put four of those Schlage touchscreen deadbolts in my house. Every door is now controlled by that. Those things are amazing, Dave.
Yeah. So I'm going to get you back on. We're going to talk Synology. We're going to talk Azure. And every couple of months, we do a home automation show here at homeservershow.com because I cannot keep away from it. In fact, there's a stack. If you look over my shoulder right there, there's a stack of tilt sensors and Z-Wave switches so I can do my garage doors. And so I'm looking forward to doing that. But Dwayne, thank you very much for chatting with me tonight.
No problem, Dave. I appreciate you having me.
YouTubers, if you're watching live on YouTube or Google Plus, we're going to be stopping this stream and we're going to restart. We're going to talk tablets. We're going to talk phones over at surfacegeeks.net. Please go check that podcast out. It'll be another G Plus live hangout via YouTube, but it'll start. The easiest way to find it is at surfacegeeks.net. There's a live podcast link over there. Everybody in the homeservershow.com chat room, we're going to move over to surfacegeeks.net. Come on over there. Otherwise, see you in the forums. Good night. All right, YouTubers, we got to tear this set down and rebuild it back over at Surface Geeks. Thanks, Dwayne.
No problem.
You going to hang out over there?
Yeah, I think I might jump over.
Badmouth me and John.
I always badmouth you.
Yeah. All right.
Hey, by the way, we got to go catch another sandwich down at McAllister's next time I'm in town.
Absolutely. Please just let me know. Just let me know. Say hi to your wife for me.
Will do. Tell your wife I said hello as well.
Will do. Tell her thanks for letting you come out and play tonight.
Well, I did get a catch pass only for you, Dave.
All right. Appreciate it. Bye. Kitchen pass. Good night, guys.